Today we're joined by Josh. Josh, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, excited to be here.
So at New Wave, you know, you're known as the watch guy.
I guess I'm a person who likes to buy watches, yeah.
Yes, and you have a Instagram handle called the Casual Watch Guy.
Yeah, because it started out as like a casual thing. Like I'm just kind of casually into watches, but that changed, so.
So tell me, what is it about? I feel like watches is something that's like a timeless thing that's almost like old world. Mm-hmm. Like, what is the appeal of like watches for you personally?
I guess like an engineering background, you kind of really like the movement of it. So like some watches that are mechanical, they don't have any battery. So it's kind of like a wind-up toy where they'll technically run forever if you like take care of it.
So just to preface for everybody, I know nothing about watches. Oh, yeah. So with watches, there's mechanical watches, mm-hmm. and then there's, which is the wind-up, more old-world art form. And yeah. then there's the digital?
The quartz. So, yeah, it's very basic. There's mechanical and quartz.
Okay. Yeah. So the mechanical is the old wind-up, and the quartz is just the...
Battery-powered. So technically, digitals are quartz watches.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then what do you think is people's fascination with that? Like, there's, like, a super niche group of people who, like, just love watches. Is it, like, the art form of how the mechanics work in the watch, like you mentioned?
I think it's all very... There's, like, different groups within the watch group. Like, mm-hmm. some people are just, like, look into watches for the investment value of it. Like, the Rolexes, you know, Patek Philippe's. They're very expensive watches that are basically stocks to them. And then there's other people who just, like, you know, wearing watches. They like the... It's, like, art and engineering combined, almost.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Art and engineering combined.
Yeah.
I understand that. So what makes like a watch like a Rolex like that much better? I mean, don't all watches have same parts? Don't they all operate the same and they're all on time to a certain degree?
Yeah, well, I guess it's mostly like a luxury item at this point, because most mechanical watches, which are the expensive ones for the most part, they're not actually as accurate as the cheap quartz ones. So like a random, you know, Target watch that runs on battery is going to be, for the most part, more accurate than a Rolex or something like that.
That is so interesting. So people only get like the Rolexes or the other brands because of the prestige?
Prestige and like, I guess prestige, and with everything, there's always, you know, quality, right? Like if you collect, I don't know, shoes or bags, you know, as the higher you go up, there's some qualities that are like more desirable in like higher brands. Mm-hmm. So like the movement itself is like more accurate in a mechanical standpoint, like comparing to other mechanical pieces. The finishing of the case, you know, the metals. And I think for me, one of my favorite parts about a watch is like the dial itself. So there's like a lot of very like exquisite like design. I don't know if that's even a phrase, but like, you know.
Totally.
Yeah, very delicately designed dials, which is really cool.
Were you always into watches as a kid, or is that something that you kind of grew into as you got older and your engineering brain started going? Or
I'd say I always was interested in watches. Like growing up, I never wore a watch because I was like a kid who runs around, you know, like kind of at recess, you know, just run around, play handball, stuff like that. So my parents don't want me to have a watch because they know I'll break it. But I've always wanted one, and like I think I got one for my birthday when I was 5, and I broke that one. And then my parents didn't get me one until like I was like 10. It's all digital watches. So I got one for like $3 in Taiwan, mm-hmm. and then broke that one. I think I got one for 25 cents when like there's a CVS closing.
Yeah.
And they're just getting rid of watches. I got one of those, broke that. And then I think what really like started the interest again was in high school, or when I graduated high school. Well, this is kind of a long story, but...
Tell it.
In high school, well, it's not that long, but like in high school, I worked for my friend's dad who like resells... or who sells things online. It's like on Amazon. He's, I don't know what the official definition of it or the term, but like he sells stuff on Amazon. Mm-hmm. And I worked for him. And then as a graduation gift, he gave me a watch. And I think it was in like a really nice box. So I was like, wow, this is really cool. Like the presentation of it. And I'll just wear that all the time. And then in college, you know, that's when like a lot of your interests like really develop and mature. That's like when I really got into it. And then having an internship, you know, having your own money to spend. You don't have to ask your parents, you know, to buy this thing. You can buy it yourself. And then that kind of fed the addiction a little bit. But the actual addiction, like full-blown addiction started when, like, during COVID. Because mm-hmm. there's nothing else to do. So I'm online, you know, looking at watches. and then just experimenting, I guess, buying whatever I like, and then kind of learning about it that way.
So currently, where you're at is that you purchase watches, and then do you resell them? Like, what do you do? Do you collect them? Like, what is your thing?
Yeah, so I guess, I don't know what my thing is. I like to say, like, I'm collecting them for, like, a bigger purpose. I wouldn't say I resell them that often. Like, I resell some of them to my friends, like, you know, here. but for the most part, I collect them because I like them. And then I also have Instagram, so I kind of like having a variety on my page. And I think that attracts more followers. That's my excuse for buying a whole bunch anyways.
Sure.
Yeah.
So I did take a peek into your Instagram, and all the photos are, like, so beautifully shot. Do you shoot them yourself, or?
Yeah.
You do? Okay, so of every single, like, image of the watch that we see on Instagram, you have?
Yes.
Currently.
A lot of repeats, though, so it's not like I don't have 400 watches. There's, like, a lot of repeats.
I see.
Yeah. I think, like, one day, I think Michael took me out to, Michael Lin. He's on the media team. He's really good at camera stuff.
Oh, yeah.
he took me to, like, Santana Row and Crate and Barrel. And he just kind of taught me the basics of, like, a DSLR camera. Because I used to, like, only shoot on the iPhone. But, like, there's a lot of limitations to that. So a lot of credit goes to Michael Lin.
So what do you think, you know, from your experience of, like, collecting now, like, what makes a watch more collectible or valuable than than another one? Is it like shoes, like the Jordans, like those limited releases, or like how does that work?
Like in terms of monetary value, or
I'm curious, do people collect things only for monetary value, or is there something that's not as expensive but still just as coveted, if not more?
Yeah, I think a lot of people, I think most of it, it's like supply and demand, like basic economics. Like with Rolex, you know, you can't buy a Rolex, you can't walk in the store and buy a Rolex right now, like for retail price at least, just because they don't make that many and everyone wants them.
I didn't even know that. Yeah. So what, you have to go to the black market?
Well, they call it the gray market.
Okay, the gray so market.
They're not authorized dealers, but like they buy it and then they sell for like whatever price they want. Because like authorized dealers, they have to, there's a certain price range that they can sell it at. It's very limiting, I think.
So they don't make Rolexes at all anymore?
Oh, they do, but like
limited
quantity. Limited. Well, not very limited. They make quite a bit, but like the demand's so high that they don't come into the stores anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can only try them on in the stores. You can't actually go in the store, pick one out, and take it home.
And then where, so it, like say if somebody was in the market for a Rolex, or what's comparable, the Patek that you mentioned?
I'd say it's like a little higher. Well, I don't want to be like a snobbish about it.
Yeah,
like,
snob, it's okay.
It's like I consider it a little higher than Rolex in terms of prestige and like how they make it, I guess.
Is that the top line?
Or is it's there one of the top that I consider. I honestly haven't explored that far up the line just because if I can't buy it, I'm not interested in it that much, you know? But there are a lot of crazy watches out there. There's like watches that depict the solar system and like kind of rotate. It's kind of weird, actually. It's not even a watch anymore.
Yeah, like, can you break that down for me? What do you mean? Like, it's like they literally have like planets orbiting that, like, and then you have to tell the time through how it orbits?
Honestly, I think it's just more of a kind of cool thing.
Okay.
But I don't know if you can tell time. I think you can tell time on it, but like, obviously, people who buy those watches, they're not going to tell time with it.
Oh, it's more for like viewing the planets.
It's more for like, yeah, showing off.
Got it.
Yeah.
So if you were interested in getting one of these like more prestigious watches, and you talked about the gray market, like how does one enter into the gray market? Is it more like online retailers or?
Yeah, it's mostly just like online retailers.
And then is that through eBay or through other avenues? Is there a certain like Watch World website where like there's like all these dealers?
There's a lot of online watch like resellers. Yes, like Joma Shop's one of them. Like there's a lot of different websites that sell watches, and then since they're not authorized, they can just sell them like whatever price they want. Actually, I think Joma Shop might be like a authorized dealer, but there's a lot of websites out there, so it's not as sketchy as it sounds. And like a lot of them do go on eBay and sell too.
Yeah. Can you recommend like in what are like are there it's like high end watches, mid grade, basic?
Yeah.
Can you recommend a couple from your expertise that you think are like good to highlight for people if they're interested in watches?
Yeah.
And why maybe?
I think a good brand to start in with Seiko for sure, just because the affordability and like the quality that they bring, you know, with the watch. Obviously affordability in the watch industry is very relative.
I was gonna ask, like, what is can you even speak to that? Like, what is an affordable, like, watch?
So, like,
median price.
Yeah. So I heard the argument that, like, people get mad sometimes when they hear affordable watch because they're like, oh, you know, it's affordable for some people. But I feel like it's more of a general, like, price range.
Sure.
Yeah. So, like, maybe, like, under 1,000 is probably, like, considered more affordable.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, anywhere 1,000 or more, you know, 1,000 to 10K is, like, luxury, I guess. And then anything above that is, like, you have a lot of money.
So if you were to do, like, a progression for somebody starting out, you would say, hey, like, start out the Seiko.
Yeah.
Sorry, how do you pronounce it?
Seiko.
Seiko.
Yeah. Sorry. It's okay. Well, you are kind of a psycho when you, like, buy a bunch of watches, so
okay,
it is so accurate.
So you start out with a Seiko,
yeah.
And then what's the next, like, level of, like, watches you would recommend?
I feel like once you kind of know what you want, it doesn't really matter.
Okay.
Because, like, Seiko, like, I'd say is a good starting point, but, you know, it's not, like, a beginner's watch, if you know what I mean. It's not looked down upon. It's like, oh, you know, he's a beginner because he has a Seiko, you know?
Yeah.
It's just like a watch that kind of embodies everything at that price point. You know, they have good automatic movements or mechanical movements, like cool dials, and offer a relatively affordable price.
And those are the things that people look for in a watch?
Yeah, for the most part, yeah.
Yeah.
I think most, like, watch people, they enjoy the... For my group of watch people, they enjoy the movement and, like, like all the specs of it. Like, some people might like it just because, you know, it's jewelry to them.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more of, like, a highlighting piece, you know?
Yeah.
Like a necklace or something like that. So, like, yeah.
So like, a watch to a guy is probably, like, the same as, like, jewelry for a girl. Like, whether it's, like, a ring or a diamond ring or things like that.
I guess so. I think it's, the way I see it, it's, like, because I was a car guy. Like,
okay.
Quote-unquote car guy. I like cars. But, you know, cars are expensive. And that's how I got to watches, because it's kind of similar, where, like, there's performance involved with, like, the accuracy of, you know, the movement. You can modify it if you want. It's kind of just a hobby, I guess.
What is your dream watch that you would want?
Oh, I don't know. There's a brand called, like, Audemars Piguet. I don't know if I'm saying it right, because it's, like, you know, European.
Yes.
But it's, like, AP. They have, like, a watch called the Royal Oak.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very interesting. It's like a hexagon shaped, like, case. And it's very hard to get. Honestly, it's a pretty basic looking watch. Like, if you saw it, you probably wouldn't think it's worth, like, up to 100K. But that is, like,
up to 100K.
Yeah. I think, like, some specs can get up to 100K, especially after it reaches, you know, the reseller's market.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it's that because of just how it's made and all of the
details
that go into it.
But also, like, a lot of company history, you know, the quality of it, and again, like, the supply and demand of it.
Can I ask, like, for luxury watches, are they handmade now, or are they, like, do they preserve that craft in having it being handmade, or is it made by a machine?
A lot of the expensive ones, yeah, are handmade.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then where are, like, is that Switzerland? Like.
Yeah, I think the Swiss, like, are the most well-known for the watches.
Yeah.
But the Japanese watches are really good, too. German watches are pretty nice.
Mm-hmm.
I think the U.S. used to have a pretty good, like, pretty good brands. Like, Timex. Timex is still, like, mostly in the U.S. But, like, Hamilton was also another one. Bulova. But they've all been bought, you know, by other big watch groups, like watch companies.
I see.
Yeah. But Timex is, like, still, like, the one of the remaining big American brands.
Yeah. Okay. And then... You mentioned earlier that you have an Instagram page, right? And this is, like, a hobby for you.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm sure, I mean, people probably come to you to consult. Like, do friends come and just ask you when they have?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Like, what's it called? They bring up, like, watches to me. They go, what do you think about this watch? And I kind of give them, like, my thoughts on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm not that, what's it called? I wouldn't say I'm that good of a advisor on watches. Just because, you know, I'm in that kind of... That boat where I think, you know, if you like it, you know, you should just get it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not, like, snobbish about, oh, you know, that one's not good because of this and this and that. Like, that's why you shouldn't get it. Well, I'll give you my opinions, like, why I wouldn't get it, or why I would get it. But I wouldn't be like, oh, don't get that one.
I think that's good though, because that's actually like a fair assessment for people, and it's like not too biased, and they can like make their own informed decision. So I think that's actually the right way to go if you're like a true consultant, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Because in the watch community, there's like a lot of quote unquote watch snobs. It's very controversial when people say, I don't like this watch, because a lot of people take it personally because they really like their watches. And it is like a lot of them are a good amount of financial investment too. So they feel very personally about their watches all the time.
Where do you feel like you want to go with this hobby and this passion?
Yeah, so I'm an engineer by trade, like software engineer by trade. So I've been building like a website, and I've been hoping to, use my Instagram as marketing, like, and then drive it towards the website and eventually become, a gazillionaire and buy a bunch of watches.
Amazing, and be
Just
like a
kidding.
watch influencer.
I guess so, yeah.
What is the kind of content that you would want to share with people on the website?
I don't know, just like my thoughts on like the watches I have. So like kind of review piece, I guess. But somewhere you can easily see, what watch I've owned, how long I've owned it. Because like right now on YouTube, you see a lot of like influencers. They kind of just review a watch, but they really only like see it for the video, They don't actually have a lot of experience or time with it.
Oh, so they're just really doing the unboxing and that's about it.
Yeah, unboxing, like, first impressions. Sometimes you want to know, like, oh, how's it going to be like a year from now, like or 2 years from now? Especially with a watch, because they're a lot of them are like long-term like purchases.
Yeah, like life, almost lifelong investments in a way.
Yeah, you can pass them down to your kids, like.
I've always been like fascinated with that because people who really care about it, like there is an aspect of like just having it be an heirloom and it being passed down. So.
And like if it's like all mechanical, theoretically it'll run forever.
And then how much when a watch breaks, like when you have something that's like a higher, more complexly made, like how crazy is it to get it fixed?
It's pretty expensive, yeah. Like some watches even need servicing. So like if it runs slow, or you notice it's not running as it should be, you have to get it serviced.
So it's like a car, like there's maintenance involved.
For the higher end ones, yeah. Because like you want to preserve, everything. If it's like lower end, sometimes like, oh, yeah, it's whatever. I'll just buy another one. Like sometimes it's cheaper just to replace it when it's like in the lower price tiers.
I wonder, as like an engineer, have do you like do you fix watches, or have you ever taken a watch apart and like tried to put it back together and all of that?
Yeah, I had a. There was this one video I was trying to make about like me replacing a movement, and I completely blew up in my face. And then I stopped posting videos for a long time just because I got tired of like, I don't know. But yeah, I have. It's a very complicated because everything's really small too. So like, seeing things is like really hard.
Do you
And
have to
like,
wear those like binocular glasses that you see
I'm at
on
an age where
movies?
I don't have to yet.
Oh, lucky you.
But I mean, I haven't really like gone that deep into like fixing watches yet. But like all the screws are so tiny. Like you need like special screwdrivers, like tweezers, stuff like that. And just it was too much for me.
Well, maybe one day there's still hope. We'll see you make that video.
We'll see, we'll see. Well, the hope is I become a gazillionaire and just like, buy whatever.
Totally. But I'm happy to hear that you have the aspirations of building out the site, the blog, the reviews. And even like it sounds like with what you're saying about the YouTube, like there's still a gap in terms of like how people explain about each kind of watch. So maybe that's something you could do too.
Yeah, for sure. Because like sometimes when you watch YouTubers, a lot of them are sponsored, a lot of them have their own like online shops, so you don't really know if they're trying to sell you a watch or really like speaking like, from experience.
And then I wonder, as a watch enthusiast, are there like watch clubs or like
Oh yeah.
conventions or like
Yeah, there's a lot of, like a lot of the I think there's something called Baselworld, where it's like all the watch companies come out and like they show their the newest lineup. Like a lot of people go to that. Like on Facebook, there's a lot of watch communities. Instagram is a very big watch community where everyone just posts pictures of their watches and like comments on them. It's kind of weird actually. You just post pictures. It's like show and tell on Instagram basically. And people really enjoy that. I know a lot of people who are on Instagram like constantly just like looking at watch photos.
I
Me
bet.
included.
Awesome. So, I'm just very interested to see where you go with this and where you take it. Because how long have you started the Instagram page? And
I think I
oh, during the
started
pandemic, you
yeah during the
mentioned.
pandemic. I think there was a span in time where I posted a picture like every single day for an entire year.
Wow.
And it got really tiring.
Yeah.
So now I'm like posting every week now. So. Mm-hmm.
Do you get sponsorships from other companies that like
want I
you
do, to promote? Yeah.
Okay.
Like Timex sent me, I think around 10-ish watches, like 10 plus watches.
That's amazing. Yeah. And you get to, do you get to keep?
I do get to keep it.
You get to keep all of them? Okay,
yeah. I mean, as long as I take a picture, you know, use the hashtag, promote it a little bit.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. Like a lot of straps too, like strap companies, they send me like there's watch straps.
Yeah.
Because I think, I don't know if you know, but like a lot of watches, you can switch out, mm-hmm. you know, the metal brace and stuff like that. So a lot of watch company, strap companies send me straps.
So isn't that pretty cool though? You're like living out your dream of like collecting all these things.
It is pretty cool. I think the coolest one was actually participated in a Seiko contest.
Yeah.
Where it's like, I think the whole thing was like the brand or the model is called Seiko 5, right? So you go into the community and find a 5 and take a picture with it.
Oh.
Yeah. So I went to like the Apple campus in Cupertino, mm-hmm. like the old one, and they have a bunch of numbers out there. And so there's a giant 5 there, and I just took a picture and I won 5 free watches.
Amazing. Yeah.
And they're all like automatic watches that are, you know, pretty decently priced, like $200-$300. I got 5 of them and that was pretty cool.
Yeah. Do you have a dream collab?
I don't know. Cause I feel like the watch companies, they try to collaborate with like non-watch community people,
celebrities,
mm-hmm. you know. They don't really try to sponsor people from the watch community. I guess that makes sense because, you know, then people won't trust them as much.
Yeah.
You know? But a lot of people like see athletes wear that. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
And they're not really, I think that's what people see athletes wear. It's not really about like the watch anymore. It's more about like the prestige.
The clout. Yeah. Yeah. There was like a year ago or 2 years ago, there was like a watch that was so popular. More commercial grade, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. But every single celebrity was endorsing it. Do you know what I'm talking about? It's like this, it was like a really clean face, like minimalist watch.
There is
I should have like looked it up. I forgot. Like Kendall Jenner was a.
Oh yes. Okay. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Like, do you think watches like that are good, or is it just literally just to get the word out and to?
Yeah. So those watches are like considered fashion watches.
Oh, okay.
So like a lot of people in the watch community don't like them just because they put more money into the marketing than the watch itself.
I see.
So like a lot of them are very basic, you know, quartz movements. Like not all quartz movements are basic. There are some like. Some quartz movements that are really expensive, like from Grand Seiko, that are mm-hmm. very accurate. I think in the whole year, they only use like 1 to 2 seconds in the whole year. But like the movements they use were very cheap. Mm-hmm. Like maybe like if you buy them in bulk, it can be under $1 or something like that.
I see.
And then they just kind of stick them in these minimalistic looking cases and dials, which I actually do like the look of.
Yeah.
Like, don't get me wrong. They do look really nice because like a lot of people, they buy a watch as a fashion piece, you know?
Right.
And that's how I kind of got into it because, like, you know, it's a nice accessory to have.
Yeah.
But anyways, back to the point. They sell those for like $100 and $200, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of other watches that are much better specs wise that you can buy than these fashion watches.
That probably last a lot longer too, right?
For sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
And like the only reason people buy these watches is because the celebrities are endorsing it, and the celebrities don't know what they're endorsing either. So a lot of people, it gets a lot of hate from the watch community.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
I wonder, like, you know, girls, like, they could spot a handbag a mile away. Like, is it the same with like guys and watches? It's like, does your eye automatically go to somebody's wrist if they're wearing a real watch and not an Apple watch?
Yeah, for me, yeah. Like, I was in the office one day, and then like some guy was walking by, and he sat across from me. He's like, "Oh, is that a like Omega Speedmaster?" I was like, "Yeah, you have good eye. Like, how'd you know that?" Like, "Oh yeah, I recognize, you know, the case shape, you know, the dial color. There's some things like that stick out to me."
Yeah.
Like when I watch movies now, I think being a watch person has ruined watching TV shows and movies. Because like,
really?
I'm always looking for what watch they're wearing.
Yeah.
And I get too caught up with that. And then I miss the plot, basically. Yeah.
And then when they're wearing the watches in the shows, are they usually good ones or bad ones?
For the most part, they're pretty good. Because like, I think a watch says a lot about a person, too. So they really take that into their character building. You know, like a lot of watches could be like a more blue-collar watch. Like, or a, you know, flashy, you know, just luxury watch, you know, it kind of says a lot about character.
Yeah. Cool.
So I think it's a very big, deep rabbit hole that I've fallen into.
I know. I'm like, I want to hear more about it because I think that, I know like this, I'm like your typical like surface person mm-hmm. when it comes to watches, but I know there's so many layers.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I think I was watching NCIS, like the original ones, and I was looking at all the watches, you know? Like, I don't know if you're familiar with the show.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so there's DeNozzo, you know, he's kind of flashy, you know? Mm-hmm. So you can tell by his watch, you know? He has, like, a Tag Heuer Monaco. Yeah. Well, at one point, he had one. And it's more of, like, a flashy, showy piece.
Yeah.
You know, and Gibbs has, like, a Omega, you know, I believe it was, like, some kind of Seamaster or Planet Ocean Seamaster. So very, like, workman kind of thing. Very durable. Mm-hmm. It kind of, like, shows, you know, the character.
Yeah, and their personality and who they are.
Exactly.
If you were to try to, like, tell somebody or, like, get somebody to engage in the watch world, mm-hmm. like, what is, like, your pitch for that?
Honestly, just hand them a really nice watch, like a mm-hmm. nice watch, like a Seiko or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know how. So I got like my friends into it. I don't remember how that really started, but I'm pretty sure I just showed them like one of my watches, kind of explained like, oh, this watch doesn't have any batteries. Mm-hmm. It kind of blows them away. Like, oh, what? This watch doesn't have any batteries at all. How does it move? I'm like, oh, you know, it's all mechanical. It's all wind up. And then I guess like it's also because a lot of my friends are engineers, so they're really interested in that engineering side too. And then, you know, they see, you know, the watch itself, like, oh, it's really nice. You know, the metal finish is really nice. Mm-hmm. And other people are like, oh, you know, it matches my outfit. You know, I like the look of it. And then once I tell them more about it, they begin to want, you know, like everyone wants the best, you know, like, or the best value. I think our culture, they want the best value for their money. Mm-hmm. So I kind of explain to them how you can do that with a watch. And then that's how they kind of get into it more.
Okay.
Yeah.
Amazing. Well, thanks for chatting with me a little bit and sharing with me your world of watches. Again, I'm like excited to see where you take this. I always think it's great when people like really actually develop their passions and it's not just something that's stagnant.
Yeah.
And it sounds like you're totally doing that. So.
Yeah, it hurts the wallet, but it's good for the soul.
Well, hopefully you get more sponsorship so it doesn't hurt the wallet.
I hope so too, yeah.
What is your future website going to be called? Or if you're not ready to unveil, that's fine too.
Oh, I bought the domain name already, so it's going to be called Collect State.
Okay.
So kind of like, you know, the state of your collection, Collect State.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
And so my commercial idea is, you know, to have celebrity come on and be like, you know, I'm Clay Thompson and this is my Collect State.
Yeah.
And they kind of pan over his collection and then that's kind of the whole commercial.
Ooh, I really like that idea. Yeah. It's almost like an MTV Cribs, but like watch edition.
Yeah, or just anything.
Yeah.
So
that's really cool.
That's my commercial idea.
Is that going to be a separate entity from the Casual Watch Guy?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I guess so. It's like, because Collect State is my website idea. Mm-hmm. Casual Watch Guy is the marketing to drive it towards, you know, Collect State.
Amazing.
Ideally, I have to get the website up first, but
yeah. You know, well, that's in the making already. That's step one.
Yeah, it's kind of funny though, because like, I tell my friends all the time, like, oh, we're gonna be gazillionaires. I'm gonna buy this building, buy that building, and my website's not up. So my dad always tells me, you know, maybe you should get your website up first. You
You're know? Like, right.
Yeah, like, oh yeah, that's a pretty big step.
Yeah.
But I'm like a very forward-thinking, dreaming, you know, kind of guy. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it's good to be a dreamer. Yeah, it really is.
It's fun to dream.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, we're looking forward to that.
Yeah.
And we're going to check in with you and hold you to that for the State Collective. Collect State.
.com.
And at the Casual Watch Guy.
Yes. At the Casual Watch Guy Instagram.
Yes. Thanks, Josh.
Yeah.